I'll be right back. So Heather, I think that I'll begin. Is that okay?
What's that?
I think I'm going to begin now. Is that okay?
That's perfectly fine.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
You bet. Thank you. So good evening, everybody. My name is Mark Cruse, and I am an associate professor of French at Arizona State University, coming to you live from sunny Phoenix, Arizona. I hope that you are all well and your loved ones. I'd like to begin by acknowledging the generous support for this lecture series, the Sheppy Dog Lecture Fund, which was established by Dr. Alan Klein. This fund allows the Flint Institute of Arts to have lectures addressing topics of art, religion, and history prior to the 19th century. I believe that Dr. Klein is joining us this evening. And so Dr. Klein, I would just like to express my gratitude and say how lucky the FIA is to have a benefactor like you. I'd like to thank Heather Wright and Catherine Sharbaugh for the invitation and for the support in putting this presentation together this evening. So you may be wondering why a French professor is going to speak to you about Asian art and medieval European art. And the answer is that I am also an art historian. I've been lecturing at the Metropolitan Museum for 24 years. And I'm also writing a book right now on contact between France and the Mongols in the late Middle Ages. So contact between Europe and Asia is very much on my mind, and the influence of Asian art on medieval European art has been something that I've been thinking about for quite a while. For those of you who have been attending other talks in the series, you may recall that in November, Griffith Mann, who is the head of the medieval department at the Metropolitan Museum, spoke to you. I'm also going to be speaking a fair amount about the Met's collection this evening, but from a completely different angle. There will not be any overlap. But I hope that this talk, like Griff's talk, will be an inspiration to many of you who have not visited the Cloisters Museum, which is the medieval branch of the Metropolitan Museum of Art, to make the pilgrimage to Manhattan, to Upper Manhattan, and visit that extraordinary medieval collection. We're going to save questions to the end. I will be giving my email address at the end. If I am unable to get to your question or to answer your question, I welcome contact from anybody. I teach at the nation's largest public university, and I believe in public outreach. I think it's very important for us to be able to speak with the public and answer your questions, so feel free to be in touch. And finally, I'm going to speak, this presentation is going to be more thematic, and perhaps as a result, more impressionistic than strictly chronological, but I hope that it will be instructive and satisfying nonetheless. So with that, let's begin. And we're going to begin with this map. And the reason we're beginning with this map is that it tells a couple of very important stories that underpin my approach to the topic of medieval culture and history. First of all, medieval studies as a discipline really began in the 19th century and was born out of competition between European nation states. And the imprint of that origin is still very evident in medieval studies to this day. We talk about medieval French architecture, medieval German music, medieval Italian politics, or what have you. And in fact, these adjectives are misnomers. There was no France or Germany or Italy in the medieval period, or at least they were nothing like what they are today. Medieval boundaries and medieval authorities and polities worked very differently from the way that they work today. And so what has happened is that this nation-state nationalistic model has deformed in many ways the way that we think about the Middle Ages. We imagine boundaries, we project them back onto the past. We imagine, frankly, that there's such a thing as Europe when Europe's existence is actually quite questionable. So that's another thing I like about this map is that it reminds us that Europe, Asia, and Africa are all contiguous land masses. You can walk from Scandinavia to Vietnam. You can walk from Siberia to South Africa. And so what a map like this does is explode all of our understandings about boundaries and border controls and the things that block movement. What we see on this map is that migration has always been possible across these land masses since well before there were anatomically modern humans. Early hominids were walking out of Africa and covering Eurasia. Animals, plants, you name it. This is a zone of constant migration and contact from prehistory down to the present. So that's another thing that I want us to keep in mind this evening, is that we are not talking about a period like ours with strict controls of borders and movement of people and goods. We are talking about a period when there was much more fluidity and much more contact in many ways between cultures and regions, even over vast distances, even though they didn't have trains and airplanes and cargo ships. Nonetheless, there was a great deal of movement. So I want to frame this presentation very quickly, and I promise very quickly, with two slides of text to give us a brief history of the period that I'm going to focus on, which is the Mongol period. So the first thing to point out is, what is the Silk Road? Well, the Silk Road is a term that refers to overland caravan routes and to maritime routes linking Asia, Africa, and Europe from the prehistoric era to the present. And I do mean to the present. Some of you may be familiar, for example, with China's Belt and Road Initiative, by which China is effectively recreating the historic Silk Road to place itself at the center of financial and commercial networks throughout Asia, into Africa, and indeed reaching into Europe. That is a classic move. It is following the paradigm of the Silk Road. It is in many ways a reiteration of trade routes that have existed for eons. Now, the most famous, or one of the most famous eras of the Silk Road was that of the Mongols. And that period dates from roughly 1206, when Genghis Khan unites the steppe tribes under his authority, until 1368. Now by 1241, The Mongols had reached Hungary, Poland, and Austria. They had made it to the heart of Europe, thereby linking Europe directly to this empire that they were creating, making Europe effectively part of the world system that the Mongols had created. And that's going to have a profound influence on every aspect of European life. In the mid-1240s, Pope Innocent IV will send a number of envoys, ambassadors, to the Mongols, both in Persia, the Mongol lords known as the Ilkhans, which means the little Khans, and all the way to Mongolia. And the most famous of these early ambassadors is a man named John of Plano Carpini, a Franciscan monk, an Italian, who will write an account of his travels and write a very detailed description of the Mongols, of their way of life, of their way of war, of their gastronomic habits, etc. And so what we have beginning in the 1240s is very intense contact, rational contact, scholastic contact between Europe and the Mongols. And the Europeans start to gather a very rational, deep, intimate understanding of who the Mongols are. Plano Carpini's text will be copied into the Encyclopedia of Vincent of Beauvais in the 1240s and 50s. This text will be copied throughout Europe, throughout the Middle Ages, and then printed and is still in print today. One of the most important encyclopedias ever. So the Mongols become a part of world encyclopedic history as of the 1240s. Another important figure today who we'll come back to is the Franciscan monk William of Rubruck. And Rubruck travels to Mongolia ostensibly as a missionary, but in fact, he's on a diplomatic and espionage mission on behalf of Louis IX, King of France, whom we know as Saint Louis. Rubruck also writes an account of the Mongols that survives to this day, that was in fact not that well known in the Middle Ages, but he sent it to King Louis IX. So the King of France had this account of the Mongols, also extraordinarily important for historians of Central Asia and East-West contact, and we will come back to him. You're all familiar with the name Kublai Khan. And the reason is that he was the grandson of Genghis Khan, and he was the ruler of the Yuan or Mongol Empire in China. And so he is the supreme Khan in the second half of the 13th century. He will be served by, among other people, another name that you know, and that is Marco Polo. Marco Polo was born in Venice around 1254. As a teenager in 1271, he sets off for the East with his father and uncle. He will spend 24 years overseas, much of that working in the service of the Mongols in China. In 1298, he writes his account, which of course we still know to this day, one of the most famous travelogues in history. And Marco Polo is gonna be very important because we're gonna talk about images, illustrations of his travel account that were produced especially in the early 1400s. And we're gonna see how his travel account continues to be a zone of contact between East and West. In 1307, there was a Catholic archbishop consecrated in Beijing. His name was John of Monte Corvino. This is a fact that is often overlooked or forgotten in histories, but it's very important. It reminds us that the Catholic infrastructure reached as far as the Far East by the early 1300s. And so when we have this impression that Europe didn't know about the wider world or didn't have contact, that's complete nonsense. There were Europeans living in China in the 13th and 14th centuries. In 1368, the Mongols will be overthrown by the Ming, who are ethnic Han Chinese, and the Ming will close their empire, and this will greatly limit European contact with China until the Jesuit missions of the 1580s to early 1600s. So that is our brief overview, and again, we can come back to this at the end if anybody has any questions about the chronology. So if we come back to our map, this is how we see this part of the world. But what I want to conclude this introduction with is how the Europeans saw the world. This is what we call a mappa mundi, which is Latin for a world map, or an OT map for the O that you see here, and then the T, which is here. This is the Mediterranean, and these are the rivers that separate Africa and Europe from Asia. And this can also be read as the Red Sea here. And we're not going to get into the complexities of this. It's an extraordinarily interesting symbolic map. The main thing I want to point out about this map is this. Notice the relative sizes and positions of the continents. And you will realize that Asia is perched on top of the world, with east pointing, therefore, upwards, where we expect north, because the upper portion of the image is the privileged position in medieval art. And you also notice that Asia is twice the size of Europe and Africa. So this is a schematic, of course, but it gives us a very good idea of how Europe understood Asia. Asia was a site of envy, of fantasy, and of fear, but of respect on the part of the Europeans. Why? Because they knew that Asia was much bigger than Europe. They knew that it housed extraordinary wealth and diversity and powerful kingdoms, and it was the site of the Garden of Eden. And therefore, Asia, although it was not yet Christianized or fully Christianized or within the Catholic realm, Asia nonetheless was a very privileged part of the world, and Europeans were fascinated with it for centuries. This is going to be very important for the rest of the evening, this European fascination with objects that come from Asia, which are therefore, in their minds, associated with charisma, with power, with sanctity, with magnificence, with rarity, with wealth, with splendor. So that is what Asia and Asian materials mean in the European medieval mind. It is not all negative. It is not all conflictual. It isn't all the Crusades and killing or heresy or idolatry and the Europeans looking down on Asians. Quite the opposite. There is also a great deal of respect for Asia and interest in Asia in this period. It is a truly global Middle Ages. So with that, our first theme this evening relates to the transmission of materials in this period. And we're going to start right off the bat with something that explains why we call this the Silk Road. This is known as the Eagle Dalmatic. A dalmatic is a long robe with wide sleeves. It's a liturgical object generally, although it could also be worn by the nobility or royalty. It was produced in southern Germany, probably in the 1330s. It might have been made for Emperor Ludwig of Bavaria. We're not sure. It's referred to frequently as the coronation robe, but we don't actually know if it was worn for a coronation. Durer, around 1510, produced an image of Charlemagne wearing this, which suggests that it might have been used in court ceremonial, but we're just not sure. Now, why am I showing you this? Because the fabric was produced in China around 1300. And what is therefore remarkable about the object is that it is a hybrid. It combines Chinese fabric with these medallions, these eagle medallions that you see here, and these embroidered hems and underarm bands that you see here, all of which, therefore, is contributing to the splendor of the object. So it's a true composite. It's a compilation, if you will, of materials from the Far East, from China, and from Germany. Another thing that's interesting about this robe is that it's presented as if its fabric were from China. But in fact, it's quite possible that the robe itself was from China. I've spoken with Chinese experts on this, historians of China, sinologist colleagues, and they think that the robe itself might have been made in China and then brought to the West at some point, and relatively early in its history, as you see, just a 30-year gap between the production of the cloth and the production of the robe itself. So this is an object that still raises a lot of questions, but right off the bat, we see why the Silk Road is so called. Because of the many kinds of objects that were being transmitted from east to west, of the many kinds of materials, silk was indeed one of the most prominent and one of the richest and most valued. I'm going to see if I can move this off my screen. My apologies. I should have moved this earlier. All right. Okay. Next. So this is a salt cellar in the Met Cloisters collection that was produced in Paris in the mid 13th century. And what you're looking at is an object that is made out of gold, rock crystal, that's what we see up here, which is the container for the salt in the shape of a boat. We have emeralds, pearls, and spinel or balas rubies. So why am I showing you this? It's made in Paris. How is it connected to our topic? Well, if you look carefully, here are these rubies. Here are the emeralds, and here we have our pearls. Although this was made in Paris, this is actually a thoroughly global object. The gold could have been sourced somewhere in Europe, but it could also have come from Africa. The emeralds also could have been sourced in Europe, but also could have come from Africa. The rock crystal almost certainly came from Africa, and these rubies could only come from one place, and that is Afghanistan. So what we see is that Paris was part of an international commercial network in the 13th century. Materials were being acquired from all over Eurasia and Africa and being reworked with extraordinary skill. But there's another reason that this is such a relevant object for this presentation. I just mentioned to you this Franciscan named William of Rubruck, sent by King Louis IX, who was the King of France from 1226 to 1270, sent by Louis to the Mongols in Mongolia between 1253 and 1255. Now, in his account, William tells us that while he was at the great Mongol, basically capital, the Khan's camp of Karakorum, he encountered a man named Guillaume Boucher, William Boucher. And William explained that he was from Paris, that he had been taken captive by the Mongols in Hungary, that he had been transported all the way to Mongolia, and that he was one of the Khan's personal goldsmiths and metalsmiths. So the story of Guillaume Boucher is one of the most interesting indications of the kinds of international contacts and artistic networks that were being created and in this case enforced, really made obligatory by Mongol conquest and movement. Because Guillaume, it turns out, makes wonderful objects for the Khan. William of Rubruck actually discusses some of these objects. Guillaume Boucher makes a belt for King Louis IX and a cross, which William of Rubruck brings back with him on his journey back to Europe. So why I find this object so extraordinary, our salt cellar, is that it was made in the middle of the 1200s by a Parisian goldsmith. It is entirely likely, in fact, it is probable, that the person or people who made this object at the Met Cloisters knew Guillaume Boucher, the Khan's enslaved personal goldsmith. So another thing that we see when we start to look at objects from a global medieval perspective is that there is a very profound human story around them, and that they have much more to tell us than just about their material reality or the sources of their materials. They actually have a lot to tell us about the transmission of goods and people and ideas across Eurasia and indeed around the Eurasian and African sphere throughout the Middle Ages. This is one of my favorite recent discoveries. This tooth was found by a group of archaeologists based in Germany, working at the Max Planck Institute. And it comes from the skull of a woman who was buried at a women's monastery in Dahlheim, Germany. And when they did the carbon dating, they discovered that she had lived sometime between 997 and 1162. And this group was actually looking to do isotopic analysis and molecular analysis of tooth enamel and tooth tartar to see what her environment had been like, what she had eaten, to see if they could find any traces of illnesses that she might have had. But when they dissolved some of the pieces of the tooth, what did they find? These very strange blue flecks. And so they cast about, they contacted physicists, they contacted people in medical history, and finally they came across Alison Beach, who is a scholar of German monastic and especially female monastic culture. And they realized that what this woman had in her teeth was lapis lazuli, which, like the spinel rubies that we just saw, was sourced and still is sourced from Afghanistan. It's a very fine mineral. It can be ground up into basically a dust, and then it can be put into solvents and into suspension and made into a very brilliant pigment. So why is there lapis lazuli in the tooth tartar of this medieval woman who was probably a nun? Well, either she was licking a brush as she painted, or she breathed the lapis as she prepared the pigments. So here we have another extraordinary example of the transmission of materials from East to West, and the way in this case in which these materials literally become part of the physical makeup of Europeans who are using these pigments. And we will come back to lapis. There's another story to tell about lapis toward the end of my presentation. But I think that this is one of the greatest finds. And if you're interested, there were articles all across the internet about this back in 2019. If you just Google Dahlheim lapis, you can find more information. The next topic this evening is the transmission of objects. So actual works of art that were produced in Asia and that made their way to the West and that in one way or the other either influenced or were incorporated into European art of the Middle Ages. And we're going to begin with this object. This object is a silk fragment with lions in procession. It comes from Central Asia. It dates to the 10th to 11th centuries. And it's from the treasury of the Basilica of Saint Servatius, which is located in Maastricht in the Netherlands. So although the cloth is from the 10th or 11th centuries, it comes from a reliquary chest that was produced between 1165 and 1200. So this silk was literally used to wrap the very small fine container that contained the relics of this saint. Now, the reason that this is so interesting is that this is far from the only example of Asian or Islamic silks, textiles that were preserved in European reliquaries. In fact, some of the best preserved medieval Islamic and Asian textiles come from church and monastic collections. And these were silks that were so highly valued, that were considered so prestigious, so charismatic, so rare, so valuable, that they were used to wrap up the sacred objects. So earlier with our eagle dalmatic from Vienna, we had the association of Far Eastern silk with authority, with imperial power. And here we see another way in which these objects are made magnificent and special or perceived as such. We have silks that are used to wrap, protect, enhance the value of relics. Another example of the transmission of objects from East to West is visible on this tomb effigy of a French knight, probably a member of the Dalhousie family, most likely one of three men named Jean Dalhousie. We don't know exactly which one, hence the date range, the 19-year date range here, because the sources aren't exactly clear on who this could be. But this is a knight who lived in the regions of Le Mans. If you know where that is about 2 hours southwest of Paris. And it's a limestone lid for a sarcophagus. There is no sarcophagus here today. The block underneath this piece is a solid cement block. And it's extraordinary for its detail, and we use it all the time at the museum to talk about a 13th century knight's accoutrements. You can see his chain armor. You can see the surcoat here over his armor. You can see the coif, which is this hood that goes around his neck that he can pull up over his head. But the most interesting detail is right here. It is his sword hilt. Now, what makes this interesting? Well, there's a really wonderful story about this. Back in the late 1980s, Helmut Nickel, who was the legendary curator of arms and armor at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, was visiting the Cloisters Museum, as he had many, many times before, countless times before. And Nickel stopped in front of this piece, which he had looked at many times before, and it suddenly dawned on him that this sword hilt wasn't right, that this was not what you would expect to find on a 13th century French knight. What do I mean? Well, have a look at this. On the right, I am showing you a sword from the Metz collection from around 1200, so not that long before this tomb effigy was carved. And what you see is that the sword hilt has these guards. These are called quillons, and they meet the axis of the blade at 90 degrees, such that the sword is like a cross or a T shape. This is the pommel up here, and you will notice that the pommel is oval shaped, and they tend to be oval or round in the Middle Ages. And you can't make it out here, but Helmut Nickel also noticed that the wrapping of the sword hilt over here was not typical of a European sword. What do we have over here? We have a trilobate pommel, not a rounded or oval pommel, and we have quillons that are thrusting up at an angle and that end in these scrolls. So Helmut Nickel goes back to his office at the Met downtown. He digs around, he contacts some colleagues, and what does he discover? He discovers that the sword hilt depicted on the effigy of the French knight is of a kind that was produced in China between the 9th and the 18th centuries. So, what are we to make of this? This is extraordinary. This doesn't seem possible. Until we start to think about the historical context, what was going on in the 1240s and 50s and 60s? Well, in 1248, Louis IX sets off for his first crusade. He will be absent from France for 6 years until 1254. And the first stop that he makes is in Cyprus. And in Cyprus, he meets Mongol ambassadors, or I should say ambassadors from the Mongol Ilkhan, the ruler of Persia, man named El-Jigadai. So we know that there were Mongols or people representing them in the Holy Land and in the Eastern Mediterranean in this period. This is therefore one possible way that a Chinese sword could make its way all the way from China to the Eastern Mediterranean. So what are we to make of this? Well, most likely the man for whom this tomb was carved, this French knight, went to the Holy Land, or at least to the Eastern Mediterranean, and either on the field of battle, or as a gift, or as a purchase, he acquired a Chinese sword or a Chinese sword hilt, an exotic object. Of course, he most likely didn't know where it came from. He brought it back with him to France, and when he died, either before he died or after, whoever commissioned his tomb felt that this object was so important, it was such a significant souvenir of his journey to the Holy Land, of whatever adventures he had had, whatever exploits he had undertaken when he had been abroad, that they decided to have it carved as a commemorating object on his tomb. So this, to my mind, is one of the most extraordinary testaments to East-West contact in this period. And I should add, for years, I used to say, and of course, there were no Chinese in the Holy Land in this period, but in recent research, I've discovered that, in fact, this is not the case. There's at least one Chinese diplomat who was certainly in Persia and probably made his way to Egypt in the 13th century. So, in fact, there were Chinese in the Middle East in this period. And so who knows how the sword got there, but it's a testament, again, to this interconnectedness that hopefully you're beginning to get a sense for. This is another extraordinary object. This is a manuscript leave, one of only six that survives from a Latin prose treatise on the seven vices that was written for the Coccarelli family, a family of merchants that did a lot of work in the Eastern Mediterranean in the 14th century. And in fact, the family had been active since the 12th century. We have records going quite a ways back for these people. This leaf was made in Genoa. The book itself was made in Genoa. That was the base for the family. But what is interesting about it is that if we look carefully, let's just go back for a second. We see down here that there are musicians. We have some sort of lord, a potentate who is taller than the people around him, the courtiers. He's in the central position in the upper register. So we know this is a lord of some kind of authority figure. And it's a feast. It's a feast scene. More musicians up here. And in fact, what this page illustrates is the vice of gluttony. And if we look at a detail here, we can see that this figure is not wearing a traditional crown, but has what appears to be a kind of feathered headgear on, is seated in a kind of lotus position in what appears to be an elaborate couch or box with dogs down here and food, and holds a bowl in both hands. Well, what's extraordinary about this illumination is that the visual language, its composition, its design, the beautiful repetitive pattern here, the dress and posture of this figure, the headdress of this figure, none of this is European. What this is a style that we associate with Persian illumination of this exact same period, of the early 14th century. This is the period of the Mongol lordship. It's really becoming anchored in Persia in this period. These are the Ilkhans I mentioned earlier. And what they do is they commission a number of great manuscripts, a number of great works in this period, including the Persian national epic, the Shahnameh, which was composed in the 10th century by Ferdowsi. And to show their sponsorship of Persian culture, to show that they appreciate the people over whom they are now the overlords, they sponsor these cultural projects, these beautiful manuscripts. And so here we have an image of Alexander the Great enthroned. Here's a detail. We see various figures around Alexander. We have a beautifully patterned background. We see him dressed in a very elaborate robe with a crown on his head in this case. But we see the central position. We see him in the upper register, and the geometry and the composition very redolent of the image that we just saw. Here's another example that's in the Sackler Gallery, also a Shahnameh, also sponsored by the Mongols, the Ilkhans in the 1330s in Iran. And again, we have a lord seated in the center in an upper register surrounded by courtiers. And so if we look at all of these together, we can see that the visual language of our Genoese image up here is clearly borrowing from Persian and Islamic sources of the period. In other words, there's no doubt that this artist had either a Persian manuscript or the leaf of a Persian book, an illustrated leaf, or possibly an image in a pattern book, which was the kind of book that artists, traveling artists, would carry around with them to sketch interesting compositions and images and then use in final works later on. Somehow a Persian style miniature was transmitted to Genoa where it was copied. And this is not the only example from this manuscript. There are in the surviving leaves, the five other surviving leaves, there are other examples of this Islamic influence. So an extraordinary example. It confirms that there was this direct contact, not only in people. We know that there were Italians in Persia in this period. Tabriz was an international financial center, commercial center, diplomatic center. But this suggests that an actual Persian illuminated manuscript made its way back to the Italian peninsula, where it was copied very faithfully. Here is another example of an object that bears the imprint of Asian influence. This represents the Marriage of the Virgin. It dates to around 1423. It's from Siena. And we're just going to play a very quick game. I'm going to move this if I can. And I want you to look at this image and see if you can find the Asian influence. Where do we see something that is not European? And I'm going to guide you a bit here. It's not the architecture. This is typical architecture, classically influenced. This is Gothic up here with these vaults, these pointed windows. It's not in the faces. These are typical stylized early Renaissance Italian faces. It's not really in the garb. The garb is what we'd expect to find in European figures. So the answer, ladies and gentlemen, is in the carpet on which the figures are standing. This carpet is very interesting. A number of years ago, in the early 1990s, the Metropolitan Museum acquired a carpet, and they weren't sure how to date it or where exactly it was from. And some sharp-eyed curator noticed that the Metropolitan's carpet looked not unlike this carpet in this painting in the British Museum, in the National Gallery. And here is the Met carpet. What you notice is that there are these confronted animal characters, figures, within whose bodies are miniaturized versions of the same animal figures. So this wonderful infinite self-referentiality, infinite regression of figures that we often get in Islamic art of the period. And once they noticed the connection between their carpet at the Metropolitan Museum and the painting, they were actually able to date this carpet. They had an idea of when it had been made and probably where, which was Anatolia, modern day Turkey. And if I dial in, you may not see it yet, but now I'm going to dial in even more and you can see the connection. Look carefully. Here's the painting. Here's the head of the creature. Here's the head of the creature. Here is the inserted body. Here is the inserted body. Here's the leg of the inserted creature, the leg of the inserted creature. Here are the legs of the large creature. Here are the legs of the large creature. And here is the other creature up above and another creature up above. Clearly, this is the exact same weaving style, the same school of weaving, if you will, depicted both in the Italian painting and in the carpet acquired by the Metropolitan Museum. So the point here is we could have spent the entire evening and indeed many, many hours just looking at Italian paintings of the late medieval and Renaissance period and talking about the influence of Islamic textiles. This is a subject unto itself. There are numerous books and articles about this topic or that touch on it, and it is a truly fascinating topic. It is far from being exhausted. There's much more to do. And as you see, these kinds of discoveries are still there to be made. So what we see is that Italian painters and other kinds of artists, like other artists in Europe, are acquiring or somehow seeing these Asian designs or actual Asian objects, and they are incorporating them into their own artistic production. Now, this brings me to a fairly vexed topic, which concerns probable, possible, and doubtful connections. And I begin this section with one of my favorite quotes, one of the most important I have ever learned. Give me two slide projectors and I can prove anything. I learned this from Professor Walter Denny, who is now emeritus. He taught for decades at the University of Massachusetts at Amherst. He's one of the greatest living experts in Islamic art. And Denny's point was that very often when you do global medieval art history, it is very tempting to see correlation and therefore causation between different works of art. The example that Denny would give was Celtic interlace and Islamic arabesque. And he would put up images of an Islamic interlace object and a Celtic interlace. And he would point out that it's reasonable, or it's at least expected, to think that there could be a connection because often these things look very similar. And so what Professor Denny taught us was that there is no reason that two cultures separated in time and space, or just in space, cannot come up with the same solution to a visual problem in the same manner, completely independently. It happens in other cultural realms. It happens in food. It happens in dress. It happens in architecture. It happens as well in visual history. So in this case, correlation does not always equal causation. So let's look at a few of these examples to give an idea of some of the things that we have to keep in mind when we talk about East-West artistic connections in the past. So my first example comes from the Cloisters Museum again. This is the main cloister space. I'm mainly just showing you this to give you a sense of context, but also to inspire you to go visit this wonderful museum. The capital I'm about to show you dates to between 1125 and 1145. It comes from the Eastern Pyrenees on what is today the French side of the border. This was in the Middle Ages, Catalonia. Catalonia was both in France and in Spain in this period. So this is a Catalan monastery, the monastery of Saint Michel de Cuxa. And we have a few capitals with these kinds of lions carved on them. And what is extraordinary about these lions, the date of the 1120s, before the Mongol era, before Marco Polo was born, well before Marco Polo, who again is born around 1254, we find these lions that are almost certainly, at least to my mind and to my eye, influenced by Asian examples. And here's what I mean. If you look around in ceramics or textiles in particular, you will find Chinese lions, lion objects or motifs produced in China in the Middle Ages that look very similar to this capital from southern France. So if we look carefully at this, we can see both objects have the bulbous eyes, the smushed noses, the very thickly lipped mouths, the snarling mouths, the tongue that projects from between the teeth. We notice the protruding shoulders and chest. We notice the stylized fur. It's not exact. I'm not saying that this object on the left is the model for this object, but I'm saying that the object from France is in the ballpark. It shows an influence of an original Chinese or Central Asian object, possibly a ceramic like the object on the left, possibly a silk. It could be metalwork as well. It could be an ivory object. But the point being, again, as we saw in the Italian painting, as we saw in our tomb with the Chinese sword, European artists are open to foreign objects, open to foreign influences and ideas, and they will incorporate them into their objects. So this I count as a probable connection. This is an illumination from a manuscript made in the early 15th century for the Duke of Burgundy. And it is an illustration from a text by an Armenian named Hayton. And Hayton's Flower of the Histories of the East tells the story of both a Turkish and Mongol conquest in Central Asia and the Middle East. And what this image shows is Mongols who are nomads. Now, this artist had certainly not seen Mongols on their migrations. He had not gone to Central Asia. Nonetheless, he depicts a two-humped Bactrian camel. So this person's head is obscuring the forward hump, but there's a hump here, there's a dip, there's another hump here, and then there is a pack that has been slung between the two humps. How did a Parisian artist of around 1410 know what a Bactrian camel looked like? It's a very intriguing question, and I honestly do not have the answer. The most obvious avenue for the transmission of such an image is through Italian art. So again, these Italian artists who are acquiring illumination produced in Persia or even further east potentially, come across images of camels and they reproduce them. And then the Parisian artist is copying Italian artists. That seems like the most reasonable path for the transmission of such an animal. However, and this is for the patrons and members of the FIA, of the Flint Institute of Arts, ladies and gentlemen, this is in your collection. This is wonderful. This is a ceramic camel from Tang era China. And what we see is, again, a Bactrian two-humped Asian camel with a pack slung between its two humps, raising its head. And if we do a comparison of the two, notice that I have flipped the image on the right for comparative purposes. It's quite striking. Now, again, I'm not saying that a ceramic like the one on the right inspired the Parisian artist in the early 1400s. That can't be demonstrated in any sure way. But it is instructive. It is interesting to think that there were these ceramics. They were portable. They did travel. And is it possible that a European artist at some point, perhaps not a French artist, perhaps again an Italian artist, was exposed to or saw an image such as this, an object like this, drew it, copied it, and then such an image made its way into the bloodstream of European art? In any event, a very intriguing connection that I wanted to share, especially with the people from Flint. Now, finally, we get to an unlikely connection, I would say. If the first one was probable, the second one is possible. This one is much more problematic, but nonetheless merits mention for that very reason. This is an image from the Bardi Chapel in Santa Croce in Florence by Giotto, widely considered one of the first Renaissance painters in European history. What we're going to focus on is the landscape here. It's a denuded landscape. It's made up of different layers. It slants from the bottom right up to the top left. There's a raptor up here of some kind witnessing the stigmatization of St. Francis. So we're really focusing on this block of rock here. Because if we go back to our manuscript that compiles all of these travel accounts that was made for the Duke of Burgundy in Paris around 1410, we come across a similar kind of landscape. Here we can really see a Parisian artist influenced by Italian art, perhaps even an artist in Paris who traveled to Italy or was from Italy and brought Italian Renaissance illusionism into Northern European painting. If you look carefully, even though there's green and there are plants on this landscape, if you imagine this denuded, it would look almost exactly like Giotto's landscape here. There's no question that there is a direct, if you will, inheritance running from this image back to an antecedent, a predecessor in the early Italian Renaissance inspired by Giotto. Now here's where this gets interesting. Back in 1996, Lauren Arnold published a book called Princely Gifts and Papal Treasures, in which she argued that the Asian influence on medieval Western art was much deeper than had ever been appreciated. And one of her most interesting but also controversial arguments is that Asian landscape painting influenced Western landscape painting. And in her book, she reproduces this scroll in the National Palace Museum in Taiwan, and she compares it to this image down here. Now, her argument is that Chinese scrolls could easily have been taken back from China by missionaries or merchants in the 13th and 14th centuries. Now, certainly that is a possibility. I do not deny that, and I'm open to the possibility. However, I think that this is an example of give me two slide projectors and I can prove anything, because I frankly don't see the connection between this landscape here and that of Giotto or that of our Parisian illuminator down here. That I think is a stretch, but this is what can happen when you start to look for something in this comparative global medieval context. But I wanted you to be aware of this because the argument is out there and it is interesting. It is food for thought. We're now going to move to our last two themes very quickly. The first thing we're going to talk about here is transmission of subjects and stories. And I'm just going to give you one example of this. What do I mean? Well, it wasn't just objects and materials that made their way from Asia into Europe in the Middle Ages. There were also stories that subsequently influenced medieval art. And this is my favorite example of this. So this is an image illustrating Marco Polo. So here he is. This manuscript made for the Duke of Burgundy around 1410 in Paris. And what this shows is the three magi kneeling before an altar on which we see a burning flame. Now, what's going on here? In Marco Polo's text, he talks about the fact that when he goes to Persia, he stops in the city of Sava, where he goes to the shrine where, according to him, the three magi are buried, or that is what he is told in any event. Now, I should point out that this didn't work, or it clashed with medieval beliefs, because in the Middle Ages, the belief was that the remains of the three kings were housed in Cologne. But nonetheless, Polo says, no, the three kings are buried in Persia. And what's more, there's an eternal flame that's always burning at their shrine. And the story that Polo is told in Persia is that that flame is burning there because when the Magi went from Persia to Bethlehem to venerate Christ, as they were venerating Christ and leaving, Christ gave them a box with a stone inside of it. The Magi put it into their packs. They ride back to Persia. And as they're riding, they stop next to a well and they pull out the little box that Christ has given them. They look at the stone one more time. It doesn't seem like anything important to them. And so they throw the stone into the well. As soon as they do, a bolt of fire shoots from the sky into the well and just burns there in the well. The Magi realize that they have made a mistake, that indeed the child they have venerated is God. And the text, here the language gets very strange. It says, they collect the fire from the well. It's not clear how they do that, but they take the fire with them back to the shrine. And to this day, Polo says, the fire is still worshipped. Now, what we're actually seeing here is Zoroastrian fire worship, which is a very, very ancient practice within Zoroastrianism. So why do I love this image so much? Well, folks, as far as I know, this is the only image in medieval art and possibly in Western art that shows the Magi worshiping fire. In other words, over here, where you would expect to see the Virgin and Child, you have a Zoroastrian religious practice. So again, we have a kind of hybridity, a composite, a cultural compilation. We have the Magi, these very important sacred Christian figures, combined with Central Asian, especially Persian religion. So my point with this image is that stories and subjects which were brought or transmitted from the East into the West could change the very way that Western artists interpreted stories and created their images. These stories opened up new vistas and new possibilities for creating art. And this is another way in which we see the influence of the East on Western art. And finally, this evening, we're going to talk about the movement of people very quickly. And one particular example. This is a leaf from the Belles Heures, the Beautiful Hours of the Duke of Berry. The Duke of Berry was one of the greatest art patrons in Western history. He was the brother of King Charles V of France, who ruled 1364 to 1380. He was the uncle of King Charles VI of France, who ruled 1380 to 1422. John of Berry was one of the wealthiest, most powerful patrons of the entire Middle Ages in Europe. And among other things, he was obsessed with the Orient and with Eastern luxury. And so he had this prayer book made for him by the Limbourg brothers, who are very famous early Renaissance Northern artists. And in this image, we see the flagellation. Now, this image is relevant to this discussion for two basic reasons. First of all, I want you to notice the brilliant blue in the background and that beautiful vine pattern. That blue, like the other blues in this image, was produced with lapis lazuli. And we know this because in the Duke of Berry's inventories, we find a reference to bags of lapis lazuli for the illuminators. So we know that the Duke was acquiring precious materials so that his artists could illustrate his books. So that's the first thing. The book itself, which again was made in Paris in the first decade of the 1400s is connected to this global art materials network. But the other reason that this image is so interesting is the headgear, the headdresses of the figures. About 20 years ago, a truly remarkable article was published in which Joyce Kubisky, an art historian, pointed out that if you look at Parisian illumination from the first two decades of the 1400s, you see an explosion in the number of Oriental characters and in the diversity of their costumes and especially their headdresses. And her argument is that this is a result of a visit to Paris between 1400 and 1402 by the Byzantine emperor. Now, think about history here. 1453 is the fall of Constantinople. The Turks end Byzantium effectively. And so two generations before, the emperor of Constantinople goes to Europe for 2 years to try to drum up support, more money, more arms, more men to support and defend Byzantium. And what Joyce Kubisky argues is that in the entourage of the emperor of Constantinople were people from all over the Middle East and into Central Asia, people from Persia, people from Anatolia, people from North Africa, with all kinds of different costume that we associate with the Islamic realms and other Central Asian peoples. And that the artists at the court saw these people, saw examples of this costume, drew it, or actually perhaps acquired it for themselves, and then incorporated this costume into their art. So this is a really wonderful example of the physical embodied presence of Asians in Western Europe in the Middle Ages and artists responding to that presence. So we have transmission of materials, transmission of objects, transmission of stories, and here transmission of people. All of these influence in the way in which European artists produce their art. Which brings me to my conclusion. The Middle Ages were a period of intense and sustained contact between Europe, Asia, and Africa. Medieval Europe was deeply influenced by non-European cultures. I hope that that has become abundantly clear now, despite how impressionistic and non-chronologically I proceeded this evening. There is much more research to be done in this field. The future of medieval studies, to my mind, is global. And by that, I mean both in approaches, people needing to learn non-European languages and to know the histories and the art and the cultures of non-European cultures, but also in practice. We need to have people from China, from Japan, from the Far East, from India, from the Middle East, from Africa, working on the Middle Ages to get their perspectives and to have their skills and knowledge and insights into the period. So, to conclude, feel free to contact me. Here is my email address, and thank you very much. I hope that you were able to hear me. I hope that there were no disruptions. And now we have about half an hour for questions. So I welcome your questions. Okay. To Betty's question, isn't Afghanistan landlocked? So Betty, let me be clear, and I was not. The pearls would either have been sourced from the Indian Ocean or possibly from the Mediterranean. But Marco Polo, among other people, talks about pearl divers in Indonesia and in the Indian Ocean. And we know that there were networks that transited pearls from the Far East into Italy and thence into Northwestern and Northern Europe. So Afghanistan was the source of lapis lazuli and of the spinel rubies. The pearls came from either the Indian Ocean or from the Mediterranean. Elise Lewis asks, would this woman have been illuminating religious texts? Yes, almost certainly. Given that she was buried at a monastery, it seems very unlikely that she would have been working on romances. She might have been working on chronicles or such, but almost certainly, given the needs of a women's monastery, she would have been working on religious texts, books of hours, although she died in 1197, so, or before 1197, so not books of hours, but devotional books for the liturgy, or other kinds of prayer books. So yes, it's almost certain that that's what she was using the lapis for, was to illuminate religious texts. And that's why you would use lapis. Such a rare, expensive material, a material that requires a lot of work to grind into these very fine powders to make these pigments. You're doing this as a kind of devotional work. That is why you are illuminating a book like this to begin with. And so the lapis is part of your devotional work, and the lapis is itself a sign of the inherent value, the inherent sanctity of the text that you are working on. That's why we find the lapis in the prayer book that I just showed you for the Duke of Berry. It's the exact same idea. Precious materials for precious texts and precious stories and sacred books. Carolyn asks, what might be the relation between Persian manuscripts and figures of Christ enthroned? This gets us to the two projector question. Most likely none, because the Persian manuscripts that I was showing you date to the 1330s. They're from the 14th century, when this particular school of Persian illumination explodes, and when there is a great deal of contact between Italy in particular, but also other Europeans, and the Mongols in Persia. The figure of Christ enthroned is something that goes back to, if not antiquity, then certainly the early Middle Ages. It's the image of Christ that is mapped onto imperial imagery, basically, and then royal imagery. So the figure of Christ enthroned predates these Persian images that I was talking about. A comment, the crux of your lecture was based on the first geographic image where Asia held sway over Europe and Africa. You took us along the Silk Road. Okay, thank you. Question, will you bring us past the Middle Ages at a future lecture? I am really not qualified to do so. I'm not a Renaissance specialist, but that would be a topic for the FIA to look into, and there are certainly plenty of people who work on this, especially Italian Renaissance art. But I mean, you could take this up into Japoneserie in 19th century France, or global Asian art today, even manga or contemporary cinema, which is influenced by East Asian animation and other forms of art. There's a lot that you can talk about in terms of Asian influence on Western art across the centuries. How were the Persian people able to communicate with the West? I'm so glad that you asked that, Anne-Marie. Thank you for the question. I'm glad in particular because I've been learning Persian for 3 years. It's an extraordinarily interesting language. What a lot of people don't realize is that Persian is Indo-European, like English, like French, like Italian, like Spanish, like German. It's been separated from Germanic and Romance languages for a long time, but it is actually not that hard of a language to learn. It is in some ways easier to learn than Latin or Greek. It doesn't decline its nouns, for example, or its adjectives. In that way, it's a very nice language to learn. And the complexity of learning the Arabic script is actually not that complicated. It's a 32-letter alphabet. It's not that hard. So Persian was the lingua franca, or one of the main lingua francas, of the Mongol Empire. And we know this from sources across Eurasia. We have references to this in European texts, Persian texts, Arabic texts, Turkish texts, and Chinese texts. Uyghur texts, Mongol texts, all talk about the use of Persian as a lingua franca. We know that the Khans, the Mongol rulers, kept Persophone counselors by them so that they could translate. And we know that there were Europeans who spoke Persian. These were, in the records that we have, monks. These were learned churchmen who had themselves spent time in the Middle East or were from the Middle East, but were from Armenian communities or Georgian communities. And so they had grown up in the greater Middle East or in Central Asia, and they were Catholic or they had been raised within the Catholic communion, and they spoke Persian and they were able to communicate. So another interesting fact about this is that in the French National Archives, our letters, and also in the Vatican Archives, are letters from the Mongol Khans to the Pope and to the King of France. And we still have the Persian text there. So we can actually go back and see what the Mongols actually intended in their first utterance, or as their utterance was translated from Mongol to Persian. So I'm very glad you asked the question. It's a really important example of how we need to break out of our Eurocentric linguistic boundaries and think more broadly about language in the Middle Ages. Did Persian miniatures make their way to Europe, asks Maggie. Judging by the image that I showed you, the Coccarelli manuscript, yes, they did, at least in this one example. That is one example where we would think we have definitive proof of transmission of an actual Persian miniature. Although, as I said, it could have been a drawing of one, but it seems likely that it's an actual Persian miniature that artist is copying, which should not be surprising, because there were, as I noted again, European merchants, European diplomats in Tabriz, in the very city where we think these other beautiful manuscripts were produced that I showed you the leaves from. So it makes sense that a book like this could make its way into Europe and into the hands of a very skilled artist. Thank you from Carl. Thank you, Carl. Thank you for coming. Anne-Marie asks, were the Dutch already involved in trade connections in the 14th century? There were no Dutch people technically in this period. The Netherlands were very sparsely settled in this period, and they were a series of fragmented counties and dukedoms, Friesland and Gelder and Holland and Zeeland and Brabant. All of these are independent polities for the most part. And the explosion of Dutch international trade is really going to take off in the 16th and 17th centuries. Let's see. Are there any representations of possible diplomatic relation in art or other between Europe and Far East Asia? That is a wonderful question, Virag. Thank you. Yes, there are. I hesitated, but I didn't have the time. In Siena, there is a series of murals showing the Franciscans and their contacts with the Mongols in Central Asia. And one of these shows the Franciscans acting as missionary diplomats, basically. And in another one of these frescoes, we see Franciscans being martyred while the Khan sits on his throne and watches them being stoned to death and beheaded. So this is one of the more dramatic examples, but there are many examples in manuscript illumination of Western either clerics, or in some cases, I'd say probably less frequently, but actual Western lords, kings, emperors, encountering diplomats from the Far East or from Central Asia. So the answer is absolutely. And this depiction of diplomatic relations really picks up in the 14th and 15th centuries. And again, is mainly centered in Italian art. And by the time we get to late 15th and 16th century Italian art, especially in Venice, especially of the Bellinis, we start to get very elaborate images of trade missions and diplomatic missions going between Venice or Italy and Constantinople and Turkey and vice versa. So yes, very good question. Thank you. Question from Stephanie. Could you talk a bit about women in the images of the Far East? The related Italian-French images include women. Also, that amazing blue ceiling looks like stars. Is that also Asian influenced or independently designed? Thanks. So aside from the nun, the tooth that I showed you, which confirms that a woman was illuminating in Germany with lapis lazuli in the 11th or 12th century, I am not aware of any direct evidence of women coming into contact with objects from the Far East or Central Asia. Now that said, the illuminations that I showed from Paris, from the travel compilation, the Marco Polo manuscript, and the Berzer, the last image that I showed, we know that there were women working in those illumination ateliers. These were family projects, family enterprises, and there were certainly women painting in Paris in this period. So it's entirely possible that indeed women were part of this global artistic network. In fact, it's certain. I just can't point to any exact documents that prove this. The amazing blue ceiling, is that Asian influenced? Probably not, just because that's a motif that we find a lot in European art. From Deirdre, the people doing the flagellating are Asian. They're being taken in native fashion. Should we read into that? Okay. Now, maybe they're meant to look Asian. That is open to discussion. I almost showed, in fact, you know what? I am going to show you an example of something that we can say is almost certainly an Asian face. I want you to look at this face right here. This is an illustration from our circa 1410 Parisian travel account compilation. This is an illustration of Marco Polo's account of how merchants must trade in goods for paper money. This is paper money. When they enter the Yuan Empire, when they enter the Mongol Empire in China, this is the Khan over here. What's interesting about this face is that this kind of face, this kind of facial hair in particular, appears to be an actual portrait of an Eastern Asian. And so was this, was the vector for this actually seeing an Eastern Asian in the company of the Byzantine emperor or another diplomat in the first decade of the 15th century? That's possible. It could also be a copy of an Italian art object. It's also been suggested that an Asian face like this could be copied from a figurine, from a ceramic. And that's another reason I showed you that camel earlier, is because of this trade in Asian ceramics. Now, if we go back to these faces, it's not clear that these are meant to be Asian faces by any means. These are standard faces. They are stylized in the way that they are depicted. It is possible, and it's actually been argued that in other images in this manuscript, there is a desire to orientalize the visages of these characters. So it's possible, but I don't see it in this particular image. But to your point, to your larger point, are Asian features coded as negative? Yes. For the most part, we think that they are. We think that we are dealing with early forms of racial stereotyping. Now, here again, we have to be careful. We have to look at context. We have to look at a given image, the context in which it's produced, for whom it's produced, by whom, how it was read. But very frequently, there is no doubt there are stereotypical features associated with the East, with the Middle East, that are negative in the European medieval mind. And then you ask, is it likely something new that artists like to incorporate? Well, that's the thing. That's what I'm saying about that particularly Asian looking face. That is arguably new, or certainly in Northern European art. And that's why, again, that book is so interesting. It's a zone of contact artistically between East and West. We have a comment from Young. Thank you. I was wondering if there were stereoscopic understanding or view of Asia Semitic world during the time you were discussing, even within China, Northern China, Southern China, were viewed different culturally, historically, environmentally. Were there signs of sensitivity toward the differences in Mongol China and Ming China, different areas of Asia, or even Persian China, for example, in this period of Europe? So the answer to that is yes, but the distinctions that the Europeans were most concerned with in this period among Asians less had to do with what we would refer to as ethnicity or culture or society, and they had more to do with religion. The papacy, but indeed also secular lords in Europe, were most concerned with figuring out how many Christians there were in Asia, how many of them were susceptible to accepting papal authority, and how many peoples were there who might be susceptible to converting to Catholic Christianity. And this is a topic that becomes very important already even before the Crusades, but especially after the success of the First Crusade and the establishment of the Latin Christian kingdoms and principalities in the Holy Land in the early 12th century. The papacy, Latin Christendom, they start to look east and they start to want to know how many Christians there are. And another reason for this is their hope is that they can ally with Asian Christians against the Islamic powers in the Middle East. And through a kind of pincer movement, through a kind of vice movement, the Europeans can attack from the west, the Eastern Christians can attack from the east, and they can smash the Muslims in between. This is one of the reasons that the contact with the Mongols is so intense. There are periods when the Europeans are hoping that the Mongols will convert to Christianity or that they already have converted. And so it's less about an appreciation of the subtleties of cultural and social differences, and it's more about distinctions between religious communities and belief. Is there any link between the ideas of Chinese dragons and European ideas about dragons? Catherine, thank you so much. You have anticipated something I was going to get to and didn't have time for, but now I do. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you what I suspect is one of the greatest examples of give me two slide projectors and I can prove anything. This has been bugging me for years. So on the left, you have the lion head, or perhaps dragon head, hard to say, finial of the handle of this ewer made in Nuremberg, or at least in Germany, around 1500. And if we dial in on this detail and we compare it to this jade dragon's head from the Mongol period of China in the 14th century or late 13th century, there are frankly a lot of connections. We have the upturned snout, which then has the little curl at the end. We have the fangs or tusks that jut up. We have the bulging eyes. We have the stylized hair or fur or feathers. Now clearly there are a lot of differences between these objects, but this does not, to me, look like a typical European dragon or lion. Oh, we have the fur or feathers down here in the bottom of the chin. We have it here as well. So to answer your question, is there any link? This has been worked on a lot, and it seems that for the most part, the answer is no. For the main reason that in Chinese culture, dragons for the most part are positive omens. They are well perceived. And in the Western tradition, dragons are diabolical. They are almost always evil, at least in medieval Christian Europe. In terms of the visual representations of these figures, it also seems that the European conception of dragons evolves differently from that and independently of that in China. From Daniel, do we have any trade records associated with the Silk Road trade? How much information are we able to gain about Asian or other exotic trade from household inventories and wills? Daniel, that is a wonderful question. So my training is in literature and art history. I'm not a historian. I just play one on television. And I know from historians that there is a mountain, there is an ocean of material about the Silk Road. So I will give you a couple of examples. Right now, there is a wonderful scholar, Nicola de Cosmo, who is at the Institute for Advanced Study, who is writing a book on Venice and the Mongols. He has been working on this book for ages. And the reason is that the Venetians in particular kept in their Senate extraordinarily detailed records, not just of commercial transactions, but of their discussions about their diplomatic interactions with the Mongols and with people in the Middle East and in the Far East. So just from Venice, we have an ocean of material. Then, for decades, there has been an ongoing project to publish and inventory the numerous documents related to the Genoese and their various trade posts, both in the Eastern Mediterranean and on the Black Sea. So just from those two cities, Venice and Genoa, you have multiple lifetimes of documentation about the Silk Road trade. Then, going back to my point about expanding our horizons, my colleague here at Arizona State, Hannah Barker, has just published a book on slavery and the Black Sea trading posts that were set up to allow especially the Venetians and the Genoese to acquire slaves, especially from Central Asia, and then transfer these people either to the Middle East, North Africa, or in many cases, Italy. The slave trade is just now coming really into fruition as a topic. It's been studied for decades before, but it's really hitting big now. What makes Hannah Barker so extraordinary is that she reads Arabic. And she spent 2 years in Egypt, in Cairo, looking at Mamluk, that is to say, the empire created by former slave janissaries who then took over, the Mamluk Empire, which had a very active slave trade for centuries and kept a lot of documentation, just as the Italians did. Well, you have to have Arabic to be able to read those documents. So we have references there. And then there are also people working on Iberia and Western North Africa, the Maghreb, where again, we have an ocean of documentation in Arabic, in Latin, in some cases in Hebrew, relating to the slave trade between Northern Spain and Southern Spain and North Africa, and also involving Southern France as well. In fact, a fair amount of documentation in Occitan, in medieval Southern French language. So the answer is yes, and this is why we need medieval historians who have these language skills, because the more we put this picture together of the kinds of documentation in different languages and from different sources that survive, that exist, the more complete the picture becomes of what the Silk Road trade actually was. But I'll just conclude with this. Hannah Barker's argument is that far more valuable, far more important in terms of volume of trade than silk or precious objects on the Silk Road were people. The main commodity, as Hannah has discovered, or that she would argue, in the 13th, 14th, 15th centuries was people, was slaves. And as this narrative continues to expand, as we learn more, it is certainly going to change not only how we think about medieval European history, but how we think about the period of the Age of Exploration. This is already happening. People are reevaluating the conquest of the Americas, the institution of slavery in the Americas, which for a very long time was considered a break with medieval history, different, the beginning of modernity. Well, from my perspective as a medievalist, the conquest of the Americas is the moment when medieval Europe acquires the institutional and technological wherewithal to project itself globally. That's what the Conquest of the Americas is. It's a medieval event. It's not a modern event. And if we look back at the letters of Cortez or of Columbus's journal of his travels, they're talking about the Mongols. They're talking about fabulous riches in the East. They think that they're going to Asia to conquer or to meet the Khan and acquire some of his wealth. Cortez and other early conquistadors had been crusaders fighting the Turks in the Mediterranean. So the continuity between the Silk Road, the medieval trade there, and the Americas and the conquest and the exploitation of the Americas is a story that is ongoing and still being written, and there's a lot more to say there as well. Anything else, folks, before we wrap up?
Dr. Cruse, there's a few questions in the chat window.
Thank you. Okay, folks, let me just scroll through and see what I can find here. How much can we infer about the conception of Asian splendor in medieval Europe based on these examples? A great deal. We can say that, as I said at the beginning, the way that Asian materials are imported and used in European art correlates with, echoes very strongly with, the kinds of descriptions of Asian splendor that we get in medieval romances, in medieval epics, in medieval chronicles, in travel accounts like those of Marco Polo or Mandeville in the 14th century. This is what obsesses them. This is one of the reasons that in the late Middle Ages, the Portuguese will sail around Africa and go into the Indian Ocean. They are looking for this, the sources of this Asian wealth. They want direct access to it. So how does your argument fit with Europeans' views of Asia as home to fantastical races? Well, the fantastic wealth is a kind of marvel. It is something that seems supernatural or unnatural or almost impossible to the European medieval mind. And so the wondrous objects and magical stones and magical animals that are described in Asia are of a piece with the extraordinary wealth and the fantastic riches that they are describing in these texts. Was there any possibility that camels were transported to Europe and were seen by some of the artists, not only through statues or objects? Absolutely. So I thank you for mentioning that. I should have mentioned that. We know, for example, that Henry II, King of England in the 12th century, in his menagerie in London, had lions. We know that Caliph of Baghdad sent Charlemagne an elephant. So we do know that there was a traffic in animals, even large animals, in this period. So indeed it is possible that the artist had seen a camel, or that at some point in the chain of transmission of the imagery, an artist had seen a camel, copied it fairly accurately, and then that image got sent on, certainly. Were returning crusaders also a source of bringing Asian influences back to Europe? That is still discussed. So the short answer is yes, in the sense that there were manuscripts that were illuminated in the Holy Land, in the principalities that were ruled by Christians, by the Catholic Church, books that were influenced by Byzantine and Islamic art. Absolutely. And then those books make their way back to Europe. Now, did crusaders bring back ideas about construction or architecture? That's a debate. That's a discussion. It has been argued, for example, that certain forms of castle defensive construction were borrowed from the Islamic peoples of the Holy Land. It's certainly possible that textiles, ivories, metalwork, weapons, arms were brought back by crusaders as well. So that's part of what I think has to be done. I think that medieval art historians, medieval historians in general, have to pay more attention to the possible, if you will, signals, the traces of these cultural contacts of these moments when objects might have been brought back from the East and influenced the West. Genetically, where are lions and camels from? So that's a very good question. Let me just say this. I forgot to mention this. Those two humped camels that I showed you, those Bactrian camels, now only make up 1% of the camel population on the planet. They're almost endangered. So they're extraordinary animals. They're really wonderful. We're familiar with the one-humped camel, which is the African camel. And that's what appears in a lot of European art. And that's transmitted from the Arabs, from North Africa, up through Spain and Italy, up into Europe. Which is why the Bactrian camel, the two-humped camel, seeing it in a Parisian object is so interesting. If Harun al-Rashid could send an elephant, here we go, exactly right, thank you, right. So this is it, Harun al-Rashid, this is the elephant I was talking about, sent the elephant to Charlemagne, and the Byzantines would have experienced camels. The dromedaries make it to Spain. Yes, there's no doubt, or at least we imagine dromedaries made it to Spain because we see images in monastic painting, frescoes, designs of camels. And of course, it's a hop, skip, and a jump from North Africa into Iberia, and the Moors used camels as they still do to this day. People of Morocco, of Algeria still use camels. So yes, it is certainly likely that the people of Iberia, the non-Islamic peoples of Iberia, had encountered dromedaries. It's certainly possible. Asian in this lecture is used to mean east of Greece. It's a very good question. Asia, as you've seen now from the lecture, the focus has really been, I've tried to make it on Asia from Tabriz or the Caspian East. But to the medieval mind, the East was a very fluid construct. It could mean different things at different times. How do we find out about future lectures of yours? Do you have a newsletter or social media account to follow? I appreciate that. Why don't you send me an email and we can be in touch. And I think that we are at the end of the questions and we're at the end of our time. So again, ladies and gentlemen, I will just flash my email account one more time if anybody would like to contact me. And thank you very much. So Heather, shall we wrap up now?
Yep, sounds great. Thank you so much. Your lecture was very informative. Appreciate having you so much.
Thank you very much. Good night, all. Be well.
Thank you. Good night. Stay cold.